Us to talk about touchy topics in Christian marriages.
And we've probably all heard sermons about the finished work of Christ, but what does it really mean? Pastor Mark Lantz shares his perspective in Connections.
And in Israel Up to the Minute, Middle East correspondent Brian Bush joins us with an update from Jerusalem. What's new, Brian?
Well, hello, everybody. Good day from a rainy Jerusalem today. We're happy to have the rain, though. I've been talking to the fellas there. I want to tell you about some archaeological discoveries, fascinating stuff, but I'm also going to have an update on what's happening in Syria. So friends, sit back, relax, and enjoy the Harvest Show, which is getting underway right now.
And thanks for joining the Harvest Show today. Stefan and Valerie with you live in studio. We'll be hearing from Pastor Mark Lantz in a little bit, continuing his message series this week. We're also going to catch up with Pete Summerall right now, the president and CEO of LeSEA Broadcasting. Pete, thanks for joining us yesterday from METV. Great content that you were sharing there. Where are you at today?
Stefan, I'm here in Tel Aviv and right out along the Mediterranean.
Wonderful. Now, obviously, there for our tour coming in, and that's going to be, I believe, in a number of days. But what is it that you look forward to most about these trips to Israel?
You know, there's always something new to see. I hear on the news that evidently Brian's got some new archaeological things for us to look at this tour. But I'm always interested in what's going on in the country, how the country is actually doing, not what the mainstream media is doing. I've been able to watch a little bit of news while both in Cyprus and here in Israel, and some of the news that comes out of other news outlets, both based in the United Kingdom as well as the United States, does not paint the picture here in Israel accurately.
Pete, I saw some footage while I was in the back yesterday of the top of the roof of METV, and we're going to get to that a little bit later, but just sharing a little bit about METV, the importance and impact that that station carries in the Middle East, especially in days like we're living in today, where there seems to be such turmoil and so many unanswered questions.
Stefan, it's very important for us to be able to have the message of Jesus Christ, the message of peace and love. A lot of people can watch Middle East television throughout the entire Middle East, but especially here in Israel, where they can't not necessarily go to a church, they can't counsel with a pastor, but they can watch it in the privacy of their home, and they can know there is a difference, that there's something different in life. They don't have to have a life filled with hate and violence. And unfortunately, that's what's prevalent right now in a lot of people here in Israel. And fortunately, it's very restrictive. It's not all over the country like the media would maybe like you to believe. Israel is still a very safe nation to be able to come and visit. But at the same time, there are people who want to do evil things. And that's something that Middle East television, I think, presents a very positive message.
Well, Pete, I watched the presidential debate, Republican presidential debate last night. Didn't hear any talk about, or maybe I took a break, but I didn't hear much talk about Israel and support for that nation. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I recorded it, Valerie. It was on between the hours of 2 and 4 in the morning,
yes,
my time, and thankfully, I was sound asleep. So I've read some comments, but I haven't actually watched it. But I did record it. I'm going to watch it probably right after we get off the call.
Okay, so we won't worry about politics. I'm looking at that drop-dead gorgeous view behind you. We also have some B-roll of just the sun rising or setting, I think, from your hotel room. I mean, it must look at that. I mean, just gorgeous. And I'm trying to figure out why I'm not there reporting live from Israel. I think we just lost Pete just a moment ago.
We'll just stay on that beauty shot for a minute.
But look at that beauty shot. I mean, you can't buy that. That is picture perfect.
Yeah, hopefully we get Pete back in here in just a moment. And Tel Aviv is one of the cosmopolitan
yes,
areas, or the cosmopolitan area of Israel. It's where the tour group lands when they come into Ben Gurion Airport, and then they move on from places there. But we've got some great ministry partners in that city. And you don't, when you think of Israel, you know, we're thinking of the history. We're thinking of thousands of years of footsteps to follow in, of patriarchs and matriarchs of faith. We're thinking of the old city of Jerusalem and the street bazaars and all that. But there's really a whole colorful palette that you get to experience when you go on a LeSEA tour.
But you know what I love? I love about the scenery there that it maintains that ancient feel that you have when you take steps back into the Bible and you read about
it.
You know, you don't feel like, you know, this is some kind of prop. You know,
it's not a Hollywood movie set
or
Disney theme park.
I was about to say that. I used to work when I was in high school. I worked at Walt Disney World, and everything is a facade.
Yeah.
You go behind.
You take one step in the hall.
That's
behind
it.
A closed door, and
there in the Holy Land, you don't have to worry about that. I mean, just the beautiful sights and scenes. So our pilgrims are going to have a great time. Yeah. You know, I've been there two times, Stefan, and it's just awesome when you're sitting next to someone who has never been there before, and they're just like in awe, and then you become this professional tour guide because you've been there before, but just an amazing place for people to visit.
It really is.
I wanted to know, did you catch the debate last night?
I saw part of it. I actually forgot it was on. I was watching the World Series with the New York Mets, you know, kind of trying their best. But I did see part of it, and I caught a little bit after it was all done from different YouTube clips and whatnot. What really struck me was the thought of, okay, why don't these guys, why doesn't the RNC get their heads together and put something online that people can watch with a conservative group of moderators who are going to deal with substantive issues rather than, I thought Ted Cruz, I saw the bit with Ted Cruz, the pushback to the CNBC moderators where, you know, he made that point in saying, rather than asking Trump if he's a comic book villain and Dr. Ben Carson if he can do math and, you know, the guy on the end if he can criticize two guys in the middle, why don't we talk about some substantive issues? And what struck me was that in that debate, it seemed like the debate was between the candidates and the moderators more than anything else.
And you know, that's the first rule of journalism. You don't become the story. You don't want to become the story.
Well, they failed miserably on that one.
CNBC. You know, the candidates kind of pushed back on that.
They did.
There was some whining about the candidates, I mean, about the moderators. I think, though, when you're standing there and you only have 1 minute to make your case for being the most powerful leader in the world, then you should take advantage of it.
So, and I think they, by pushing back, they did exert that leadership authority, you know, because really it's the way that the questions are worded. There are a lot of gotcha questions that were very surgically fine-tuned and crafted to not have a good answer no matter what you say. If you were addressing the question rather than addressing the subject.
That's right. And you could, you know, if you watch the debate on Fox, you can tell this is a more, you know, this is the conservative network. Then you watched CNN, and then you watched this one
from
last night.
I thought CNN did a good job as well.
I thought Anderson Cooper did a really great job in moderating that, not, you know, becoming a part of the story, but it'll be interesting. I thought if I had to say someone kind of stood out, in my opinion, I would say it had to be Marco Rubio. You know, he needed to do that. Donald Trump and Ben Carson were fairly quiet throughout the entire time. Then Jeb Bush was a little disappointed that he said he only got a chance to answer three questions. Here's what I'm glad about. It wasn't 3 hours. You know, it was 2 hours.
Two hours.
So it'll be interesting.
I missed Marco Rubio's responses and the questions posed to him. I didn't see any of him. I saw a little bit of Cruz and a little bit of Trump and a little bit of Christie. But, I thought... I'd heard that Rubio did well. I thought Cruz did actually well also in his responses.
You know, here's the bottom line for me. You know, what about the economy? Mm-hmm. What about the middle class? You know, it's killing me, you know, being a part of the middle class. And so I didn't hear a lot about the economy. I think people were making the case for different things that are really important to them, but not enough substance pertaining to the economy. But that's
well, we've got a few more to go. I know the Democrat debate is coming up in roughly a week or so as well, and so we'll get to see that again. And Well, has anybody left other than Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton? Oh, you got Mark O'Malley. I think that's it, right? That's pretty much, that one's pretty much in the bag, as they say. So
I don't think we were able to get Pete back.
No, not going to happen. We'll have to catch up with Pete at another time.
But I want to remind our viewers, it is not too late for you to send in your prayer request. Pete will be going to the Western Wall pretty soon, and he's going to take your prayer request there. So be sure to call in 1-800-365-3732. You know, we have a number of ways in which you can reach us for prayer to get that information to Pete so he can pray.
Absolutely, and we'll also pray for you here. We also want to connect with you today. You can check us out on Facebook. Make sure you like us on Facebook as well, on Twitter, and you can also record the Harvest Show on your DVR so you can watch it at your own leisure. Stay with us. The International News comes up next.
Today is Thursday, October 29, 2015. I'm Bob Nagel in for Chuck Freebie with this check on international news. South Korea on Thursday reconfirmed its stance that freedom of navigation and flying should be guaranteed in the South China Sea and that conflicts concerning this should really be peacefully resolved. The comments by South Korean ministry spokesman No Kwang Il at a regular briefing came after the U.S. Navy sailed a warship close to one of China's artificial islands in the South China Sea in an act that challenged Chinese sovereignty claims. The U.S. says it doesn't take a position on sovereignty over the South China Sea, but insists on freedom of navigation and overflight. China says it respects the right of navigation, but has never specified the exact legal status of its maritime claims. China says virtually all of the South China Sea belongs to China, while countries like Malaysia, the Philippines, Taiwan, and Vietnam claim either parts or all of it. The South China Sea is the avenue for 30% of South Korea's exports and 90% of its energy imports. China and Germany agreed to boost their trade partnership and mutual investments on Thursday. German Chancellor Angela Merkel met with her Chinese counterpart, Li Keqiang, in Beijing to discuss economic cooperation between their two nations, as well as global and international issues. China is Germany's third largest trade partner in the world, with bilateral trade volume amounting to over 150 billion euros in 2014. Merkel's visit comes at a time of economy slowing in China, with its growth down nearly 7% in the last quarter. The two leaders oversaw the signing of a number of trade agreements, including one between Volkswagen AG and a Chinese bank. The third Republican debate of the 2016 presidential campaign took place last night in Boulder, Colorado, with all the party hopefuls handling questions from the panel from CNBC. Following the debate, the presidential hopefuls spoke with members of the media and answered questions in what they now call the spin room. Donald Trump defended himself from accusations that he's spreading hate among the candidates and their constituents. Trump told one reporter that he is instead promoting love. Candidate Ben Carson repeated the claim he made during the debate that Republicans get tougher questions than the Democrats. During the debate, a few of the candidates actually parried with media panel members, and they were asking specific questions, and the questions remained after the debate. Who might have had the best performance in that third debate? Well, hundreds of students were studying in the open air in Pakistan's Swat Valley on Thursday after their classrooms were badly damaged in the earthquake that shook the region on Monday. The death toll from the quake that was centered in the mountains near the Chinese border has risen to 390 and will rise further as reports come in from remote areas. In Pakistan, the picturesque Swat Valley was hit hardest, and towns that make up the Khyber Pass, like Dur and Shangla, show the most damage. Relief efforts are ongoing, but the devastation will need months of effort to repair. Well, clashes erupted on Thursday morning between Israeli troops and Palestinians in the West Bank city of Hebron as a five-week wave of violence continued. The clashes took place shortly after a Palestinian man stabbed an Israeli soldier in the head, and the forces shot and killed that man, according to authorities. Soldier was lightly wounded, according to military reports. Thursday's stabbing incident took place near a disputed shrine in Hebron, known to Jews as the Cave of the Patriarchs, where the Bible says patriarchs Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were buried along with their wives. Muslims call it the Al-Ibrahimi Mosque, reflecting the fact that Abraham is considered the father of both Judaism and Islam. And that is a check on international news. I'm Bob Nagel. Coming up later on Harvest, Brian Bush talks about some new archaeological discoveries in the Holy Land. But up next, Sheila Wray talks about 9 thoughts that can change your marriage. Harvest continues after this.
Help heal the sick, mend broken relationships, reach the lost with the love of Christ. Do all of that and more when you support LeSEA Broadcasting Prayer Line. Prayer Line is a channel of God's love, reaching more than 10,000 people every month. Your gift today will help keep Prayer Line available for free 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Go to your phones right now and call 1-800-365-3732. Give now and keep Prayer Line going strong.
If you want to do more and be more, but your stamina runs out of steam, you need the top-selling Essential Vitamin Mineral Pack by Dr. Rodrigo Rodriguez. The Doctor's Making Healthy Choices Essential Pack costs only $59.95, but the health benefits are priceless. You get mineral concentrate, an unsurpassed formula of trace minerals essential to good health. Omega-3 for overall vascular support and healthy brain function. Vita Sprouts, a superior form of multivitamins, and you get Solu-C for a strong immune system. That's mineral concentrate, omega-3, Vita Sprouts, and Solu-C, an incredible value for only $59.95. And if you act now, shipping is free. Call 1-800-965-2345 or go to mhclife.com to get the Doctor's Essential Pack from Making Healthy Choices. That's 1-800-965-2345 or mhclife.com.
In Uganda, thousands of children pour across the border, fleeing the terror and violence taking place in South Sudan. Many have nothing but the ragged clothes they wear. They're weak from hunger and struggle to survive. Today, you have an opportunity to change the life of one of these refugee children from Sudan. For just $72, you can provide food, comfort, and security for a child for an entire year. $144 will take away the pain of hunger and introduce 2 children to the joy of full life that comes from knowing the love of Jesus. Please call 1-877-769-9270 today or visit feedthehungry.org. Please act now. These children need your encouragement. They need to know they are not alone. Please call 1-877-769-9270 to help a child know how good a full life feels.
Award-winning author Sheila Gregoire has a refreshing approach to difficult relationship topics that has earned her an online following in the hundreds of thousands. Today, she returns to the show to talk about the subject in her new project, 9 Thoughts That Can Change Your Marriage. Welcome back to The Harvest Show, Sheila.
Thanks. It's good to be back.
Okay, so we had a ball the last time you were here talking about marriage, talking about the word that I dislike the most about marriage, and that is submission. But you kind of helped me out. You debunked a few myths about marriage in your new project, 9 Thoughts That Can Change It. So why did you write this book?
I think that there's a lot of advice that's often given in our Christian culture mm-hmm. that doesn't actually work and that can actually backfire quite badly. And so I thought, what if we could just look at marriage in a whole different way and see what God really wants from us?
Mm-hmm. But I'd imagine that you learned a lot of this through the 24 years that you've been married. Tried
yes,
and true, kind
absolutely.
Of.
Absolutely. You know, and my husband and I are now empty nesters. This mm-hmm. is our first year without the kids. They're both at school, and one of them's married now. So we've just bought an RV, and we're traveling around North
yeah,
America
Yeah, I saw
speaking.
Your RV out there. The,
and it's kind of small,
lot.
And yet we're doing really well. So mm-hmm. if we can live in an RV, I figure we can do anything.
I think, married women definitely want to be successful in marriage. What are some of the things that you're sharing with women around the country so that they can kind of change their perspectives about their husbands?
Mm-hmm. Well, if I can sum it up like this, I think mm-hmm. all of the 9 thoughts you could summarize this way. God wants us to be good. He doesn't necessarily want us to be nice. And yet, as women, we're raised to think, well, I'm supposed to be the nice girl. I'm supposed to make everyone around me feel nice. Mm-hmm. I'm supposed to keep a nice house. We don't want anything rocking the boat. But sometimes you gotta rock the boat. And sometimes rocking the boat is a very good thing to do.
And that helps you to be your, you know, your authentic self, right?
Exactly.
Okay, you also talk about Micah 6 and 8 as kind of the golden rule for, I guess, the backdrop for this book. Talk about that scripture.
And I think that's a great scripture for a life verse for anyone. Okay. Right? He has told you, O man, what is good and what does the Lord require of you? You know, to love mercy, to act justly, and to walk humbly with your God. And I think that those three things are so important because they summarize everything. Mm-hmm. So there's mercy, that's grace, and there's justice, that's doing what is right and pursuing what is good. And then there's walking humbly, because you can't do any of that if you don't understand that he's God and I'm not. Mm-hmm. So we got to get that humility part down. But we're not only supposed to be after mercy, we're also supposed to be after justice in our marriages and getting both of us looking more and more like Christ mm-hmm. every day.
It seems as though the enemy is definitely doing his part to change our thinking about marriage and shape our thinking about marriage through popular culture. Mm-hmm. For instance, you know, that sex makes you happy or it doesn't make you happy, or you have to go outside of your marriage relationship mm-hmm. to find intimacy. Mm-hmm. Now, I know that you're the sex lady, right? What's the title of your first book?
So 9 Thoughts That Can Change Your Marriage is the recent one, but okay. I've also written The Good Girl's Guide to Great Sex for any married woman or any woman who's about to get married, and 31 Days to Great Sex. So I talk about sex a lot on mm-hmm. my blog. It's kind of my thing. And what I find so interesting about the way our culture approaches sex is they make it sound like the people who are having the most fun are those that are on the covers of Cosmo. Mm-hmm. But actually, if you look at surveys, the people who are having the most fun are married women who are religiously conservative and who have been married for about 16 to 24 years.
I've never heard that.
Yeah, those are the ones who are having the most fun. So
yeah,
your church,
you just don't hear about it.
Yeah, your church secretary who might be packing an extra 25 pounds, okay, she's having a lot more fun than all those starlets out mm-hmm. there. Absolutely.
What would you say is the number one roadblock to sexual intimacy in marriage?
Oh, there's so many, but I think for women, it's just feeling exhausted. Mm-hmm. You know, at the end of the day, you're just so tired, and it's one more thing on my to-do list, and just leave me alone. So I think for us, a lot of it's that. And we need to change our thinking on that, because we tend to think of sex as something which is for him, right? Like, he needs it. And you even hear that from the pulpit sometimes, you know, he needs it every 72 hours or he'll explode or something like that. as if that's supposed to make any woman want to.
Right.
Obligation sex, not sexy. Bad message. But when we start talking about sex like God made it for him, then it doesn't do anything for women. Because for women, our sex drives are almost entirely here. Mm-hmm. Okay? Men, somewhere else. Women, almost entirely here. And so the messages that you give yourself about sex determine how your body is going to feel. If you're saying, oh, I'm so tired, then no, you're not going to want to. But if you're saying, I am so tired and sex will help me sleep, so let's have some fun so I can sleep, then your body's going to kick in.
Well, there can be some underlining issues there that definitely would be a roadblock. Say, for instance, with pornography. Christian
Absolutely.
Men are engaging in pornography at a record mm-hmm. number. So, mm-hmm. Address that issue.
Yeah, absolutely. And porn is scary. I mean, it is so scary what it does to marriages, what it does to our little boy's sexuality. Because what pornography does is it rewires the brain so that what is arousing is an image and not a person. Mm-hmm. So now when you're married, you can't even get attracted to your wife or want your wife. And in fact, pornography is the leading cause of all kinds of sexual dysfunction in males. And we're now seeing that a lot of men, their libido is falling dramatically, and they don't want to have sex anymore because porn has stolen their libido. Mm-hmm. So it really is scary, and you have to deal with it. It isn't something which is going to get better on its own.
In thought number 2, you say, my husband can't make me mad.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about that.
Mm-hmm. We often think that when he does something, it ticks us off and it's all his fault. Okay. But actually, you are making the decision to get mad. And sometimes when we feel ticked off, it's because of things that we have done ourselves. Like when I am tired, when I'm hormonal, when I'm feeling busy, things that he does tick me off a lot more. And so look at your situation. If he walks in late and you explode at him, all right, 20 minutes late, and you hit the ceiling. But 2 days earlier, he was late, and it didn't bug you at all. It's not the fact that he's late. it's something that's going on with you. So we need to look at our triggers. Mm-hmm. We need to look at the way that you think. I'm not saying your husband doesn't do something that's bad. Like, we just talked about pornography. And if he's using pornography, yes, you're going to be heartbroken. And yes, you need to deal with that. Absolutely. And in thoughts 5 through 7, I talk about how to deal with these really big issues. But you can't deal with those issues until you first get your own heart right.
And what about this? I'm not in competition with my husband.
Yeah, the whole way that we talk about marriage in the Christian church, mm-hmm. you know, like when you disagree, she has to submit to him, so he makes the decision. It makes it sound like he and she are always going to disagree. And God wants us united in heart and mind. He wants us to feel like we're a team. And so we have to start thinking, how can we pray about this? How can we talk to each other and understand each other and know each other's needs and know each other's hearts so that it's not about disagreement? It's not about who wins. It's about how can we be on the same page? Mm-hmm. And I think we forget that sometimes. I think actually our culture can talk about that in a better way than sometimes the church does, because we misunderstand what God really wants.
My husband is my neighbor.
Yeah, now this is an important one. How often do we treat people outside of our houses?
It's so true.
Better than we treat the people inside our houses.
Mm-hmm.
Because you might go to work and you buy coffees for your coworkers on the way. You say, oh, you got a new haircut. You look so great. And we compliment each other. But with our husbands, we know all the reasons why he doesn't deserve it. And so we stop being nice.
Yes. And withhold those praises for him. Okay, so Sheila, let me just ask you to look into your camera and encourage that woman, that married woman who's like, I'm just one argument away from leaving this guy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, encourage her and let her know that there's hope.
There is hope, because God wants your marriage to thrive, but he doesn't only want your marriage to thrive, he wants you to thrive. And you can if you start dealing with the real issues. But I'll tell you the biggest trick to doing that: just laugh together again. Just spend time together again. Learn how to be friends. We forget how to be our husband's best friend. Talk to him every day. Laugh with him every day. And then those issues will get so much easier to deal with.
Amen. Thanks so much for sharing your insights with us. To connect with Sheila, go to lovehonorandvacuum.com. Now, what is that? Is that your blog?
It is my blog. I blog every day. It's huge. We have a lot of fun.
Okay, so to lovehonorandvacuum.com, or go to harvest-tv.com for a link to her new project, 9 Thoughts That Can Change Your Marriage. Harvest will continue in just a moment.
For 70 years, we've been using shortwave radio to reach many in developing countries with the gospel. We're so thankful for your support, which has helped continue the work Dr. Lester Sumrall began. And through your gifts and prayers, we are excited to continue transmitting God's word by shortwave radio to every major continent in the world, sharing the good news of Jesus with those who simply can't be reached any other way.
The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him. My Father's God, and I will exalt him. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation. He is my stronghold, my refuge, and my savior. From violent people you save me. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Want to accept Jesus as your personal Savior, or have questions about Christian life? Call Prayer Line at 1-800-365-3732.
Dr. Lester Sumrall was given a global vision to reach a million souls every day for Jesus Christ. To fulfill his God-given assignment, he began establishing the many outreaches of LeSEA Broadcasting. today. The ministry reaches millions of people in more than 190 nations through the power of television, radio, free Bibles, shortwave satellite, and prayer line. But we need your help to reach millions more. Will you join Partners in Faith and help us spread the gospel around the world? Will you commit to giving a monthly gift of $25, $50, $100 or more? Dr. Sumrall knew he couldn't fulfill his vision without the help of thousands of partners. But don't wait. Become a partner in faith today. Call 1-800-365-3732 or visit LeSEA.com to give safe and secure online. The Bible says he who wins souls is wise. Make the wise choice today to become a partner in faith and help us win souls for Jesus.
Right, as promised, we're going to take a minute and catch up with Brian Bush, our exclusive correspondent in the Middle East. And Brian, let's start with a stunning article about an archaeological find near the Black Sea, obviously outside of Israel, but the find seems to be all about Israel.
Well, hey, Stefan, I've stepped out of the rain a little bit. We've got a little drizzles going on here. We'll see how long we can stay together. What you're talking about was actually discovered by Russian archaeologists who made the discovery near the Black Sea this summer, but it has only now been brought to light because the undisturbed grave of what seems to have been a 2,000-year-old Russian warrior woman's grave had within it an ancient Judean seal. It was first thought that the seal was Philistine or Aramaic, but it now has been confirmed as ancient Hebrew, and it says Eliashib. The seals found at this grave site, or the seal rather, matches other seals which have been found here in Israel in the southern fortress of Arad. Now, the further fascinating news is that the Carnelian seal is actually hundreds of years older than this noble woman's grave, which has everyone speculating what it all means. Stefan?
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how that develops and what the speculations are. And since we're talking about archaeology, that hasn't been the only big find of late there in Israel, has it?
Yes, the other big find was here in Israel, and it is big. It is a massive wine press holding something to the tune of 23 metric meters of wine. That was its capacity. It has a mosaic floor where the work was done, and then a mosaic deck at ground level, very large and impressive, suggesting that wine production was a major commodity and perhaps a major export for the region. It was discovered while infrastructure work was being carried out in a field in order to lay some gas lines. Stefan?
Wow. Always interesting what's being found there under the ground in Israel and throughout the Middle East. Looking further afield a bit to Syria, Russia is continuing to pound the Syrian rebel and Islamic State forces. Do you think that Russia's actions are what's kind of behind this new diplomatic push to find a solution to the civil war?
Well, you know, the U.S. has dropped some rebel groups, and it's boosted other moderate rebels with more military support. But as you say, with the Russian success at pushing anti-Assad forces further and further away from the ground that they captured and have held, and the inclusion of Iranian and Hezbollah fighters on the ground, America, if it continues at this pace in what it has been doing, is going to be left behind in the formula of bringing things in Syria to a stop and, from America's perspective, ultimately replacing Bashar al-Assad. Stefan?
Brian, as you know, a meeting coming up in Vienna, Iran just being invited to the table at Russia's insistence almost. This meeting in Vienna is going to be a testing of intentions for all parties involved with Syria, isn't it?
Yes, it certainly will be. Iran is now a player. Like it or not, Iran is there. And along with Russia, they too don't want to see Syrian President Bashar al-Assad go. They want to see him stay in power. Now, America, Turkey, and Saudi Arabia don't want Bashar al-Assad to stay in power. And at this meeting of 12 foreign ministers, which is going to take place in Vienna, it's going to be a real test of diplomacy, as America will have to weigh the desires of its allies with the reality of Russian and Iranian success in willing to do the dirty work, pound out the fighting on the ground for their man, Bashar al-Assad, there in Syria. And in fact, they are winning in this. Stefan?
Thank you so much, Brian. Look forward to continued updates as you get the news for us there right from the ground in the Middle East. A reminder that Brian Bush gives us exclusive content from Israel, but it's only available on the Harvest Show Facebook page. You got to like our Facebook page. And also, we're going to post some more pictures of that new find that was unearthed, the wine press, 23 cubic meters, and some interesting commentary behind that as well. Still to come, Valerie joins Pastor Charles with your prayer request, but up first, we're going to hear from Pastor Mark Lantz, concluding his teaching, The Power of the Finished Work. We'll be right back.
Many Christian ministries have desired to bring the gospel of Jesus to Israel, to proclaim his message of God's love to the villages and streets he walked while on this earth. Yet only one Christian network has been broadcasting the message of God's love to Israel for more than 10 years. By God's grace, LeSEA Broadcasting has been bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ and the voices of many American ministries to every home in Israel via Middle East television. You can help this great work by becoming a partner in faith for as little as $25 a month. Call today.
We're talking about the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I want to close our teaching today by giving you this point here. The finished work of Jesus, it is your supply. It is your only resource. Let's go back to our text of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, where we've been this week. And verse 30 says, "But of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption." To put it plainly, friend, you will not find wisdom outside of Jesus. You're never going to find righteousness outside of Jesus, and you will never be sanctified outside of Jesus. You know, God doesn't give you wisdom. He gives you Jesus. And in Christ, you find wisdom. God doesn't give you sanctification. He gives you Jesus, and in him you find sanctification. God doesn't give you righteousness. Again, he gives you Jesus, and in Christ you find righteousness. Even healing. Somebody say, "God, heal me." No, he gives us Jesus, and in Christ we find our healing. God doesn't give us provision. He gives us Jesus, and in him we find our provision. Do you see the picture here? You see, none of these things are gifts that God gives to us. Jesus is the gift. And out of the gift of Christ flows wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and power. And I believe that it's time for us to stop seeking after the gift and start seeking after the giver. When you look back in the beginning of Genesis, Genesis chapter 22, Abraham takes his son Isaac to Mount Moriah. He offers him as a sacrifice according to what God had told him to do. Now, Isaac, his son's already on the altar, ready to be killed. And just as Abraham is ready to sacrifice his son, the Bible says in Genesis 22 and 11 that the angel of the Lord called to him out of heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." He said, "Here I am." Now, this is an Old Testament appearance of the Lord Jesus Christ. And in verse 13, Abraham lifted up his eyes, and behold, behind him a ram was caught in the thicket by his horns, and he took the ram, offered him up for a burnt offering instead of his son. And then verse 14, Abraham called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh, as it is said to this day, "In the mount of the Lord it shall be seen." Now, Jireh means to see or to provide. But what the Hebrew means literally is that the Lord, Jehovah, is Jireh. The Lord is provision. You see, you cannot separate the provision from the provider. Jesus, this is an Old Testament appearance of Jesus. The Lord Jesus is provision. Friend, no matter where you are right now, God's saying start looking to Jesus alone to be your provider. Your bank account is not your source of provision. Your job is not your source of provision. Books cannot be your source of wisdom. Jesus is your provider. In Exodus 15, God again reveals himself as Jehovah to his people. Verse 26, he said, I am the Lord that healeth thee. Now, we translate that as the Lord being the God who heals us. But again, the literal Hebrew means I am healing. I am health. Jesus is not saying I will heal you or I will provide you with health. He's saying I am your healing. I am your health. Even when it comes to sanctification, Jesus doesn't provide you with the power to become sanctified. He is your sanctification. You don't have to become sanctified. You are sanctified in Christ. And I believe it's time to stop seeking after healing and start believing that in Jesus we are healed. Stop seeking after wisdom and realize in Jesus we have wisdom. Stop waiting to become sanctified or trying to do something to become sanctified and realize in Jesus we are sanctified. I want you to get up every morning and start saying, I am sanctified because of Jesus. I am wise because of Jesus. I am healed because of Jesus. Today, begin right now. Stop seeking after that gift. Start seeking after the giver. Because be reminded, go back to our original text here, verse 30. Paul said, of him are you in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. It is time to start seeing Jesus here and now. Friend, he is your sanctification. He is your healing. He is your redemption. And it is all because of the finished work of Jesus Christ. I believe the Lord is setting you free today. You're going to stop trying to earn your sanctification or earn your wisdom. Friend, you're going to start trusting with total faith, transparent faith in the finished work of Jesus. And you will see the wisdom of Christ begin to rise. You will begin to see the righteousness of Christ rise in you. Today is your day. Trust the finished work. Your life will be changed.
If you need prayer, this is the place to call. 1-800-365-3732 is prayer line. We're available to you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. You can also send in your prayer request to prayer@leSEA.com, worldharvest.com, and 61300 Ironwood Road, South Bend, Indiana, 46614. And Pastor Charles, we just heard Pastor Mark talking about the finished work of Jesus Christ. Thank God for the finished work that Christ died for our sins so that we can have eternal life, but not just eternal life, a life here on this earth as well. And sometimes life comes at us with some difficulties. And so that's why you reach out to us with prayer. So what do we have today? Praise reports or prayer requests,
prayer
Pastor?
Prayer requests. We're going to be talking about some of those ones who are indeed calling. We talk all the time about the ones who call.
Okay.
But I tell you what, the reason they call is because they get results when they call.
Yes.
It's not so much prayer line as it is agreeing with the ones who are here. Talking back with you. For instance, Sadie in Indiana. Sadie says, I have a friend who is recovering from drug use. She has overdosed three times.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. Please agree that God will deliver her and she will live and not die.
Amen.
And then we have Jane from Washington. Jane says, I need you all to pray at prayer line with me regarding my cousin having his leg amputated. She says he is going to need plenty of love and assistance.
Indeed.
Yeah, yeah. And then Layla in New Jersey. Layla says, I need closure to a relationship I thought was going well. She said, I had grown to love this man for a year, and I haven't heard from him in the last 4 months. She says, please pray that God helps me. And then finally, we have Chrissy in Ohio. Chrissy says, will you agree with me in prayer that God will protect me and open doors to that job that will allow me to travel? Thanks. I know God can do it. You know, we have some specific prayers,
yes.
You know.
And, you know, some people need encouragement. Some people need healing.
That's
some
right.
People need to know that God can deliver them from drugs and alcohol. God can do it all. So, Pastor, would you pray?
Sure, sure. Father
thank
in heaven,
you,
Father. We just thank you today, Lord, because we know, Lord, that you've given us an avenue, Lord God, a way to pray and in a stronger way. Father, we thank you today, Lord, for giving us that opportunity to join together with others, Lord God, touching and agreeing and allowing you to take charge. Father, in Jesus' mighty name and the power of his blood, today we speak a well word over your people, Lord, and we're asking you to move, Lord, in their favor, Lord, and deliver them from all of their infirmities. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen.
Amen. So if you need prayer, give us a call, 1-800-365-3732. Prayer at LeSEA.com is the email address, worldharvest.com, or 61300 Ironwood Road, South Bend, Indiana. And now let's listen to Christy Knuckles. Here she is at Let It Be Jesus.
Let it be Jesus, the first name that I call, and let it be Jesus, my song inside the storm. I'll never need another.
Let's play and let it. Friends like you have helped send over 700,000 Bibles around the world through our Spread the Word ministry. We're so thankful for your support to help us take the best news of all time to more of those hungry to hear it. Through your generosity, many thousands have already read about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And with your support, we look forward to helping fulfill Dr. Lester Sumrall's vision of reaching the untold billions yet untold with the gospel.
And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands. You are Jesus, you alone are worthy of.
Dear friend of mine named Rich Mullins. My deliverer is coming. My deliverer is standing by.
Help heal the sick, mend broken relationships, reach the lost with the love of Jesus Christ. Do all that and more when you support LeSEA Broadcasting's Prayer Line. Since it was founded by Dr. Lester Sumrall in 1970, Prayer Line has been a channel of God's love and source of miracles, reaching more than 10,000 people each month. Every single day, our dedicated staff and volunteers receive hundreds of phone calls and emails from people around the world who desperately need a touch from God. Some are struggling with drug addiction. Others have lost their jobs or received frightening medical news. In every situation, they find the comfort and support they need thanks to your generous support. Please don't let this critical lifeline of hope and comfort go silent. Your gift today will help make sure that Prayer Line is always available for free, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Give online today at LeSEA.com. That's LeSEA.com.
Critical news is happening in the Middle East 24/7, and I am living in the middle of it all, right here in Jerusalem.
Correspondent Brian Bush brings you a front row seat to major events unfolding in the Middle East. Brian knows the people and the land, keeping you abreast of the news with expert analysis from a Christian perspective.
Watch my Israel up-to-the-minute reports on The Harvest Show right here, only on this LeSEA Broadcasting Station.
Got Facebook? Follow The Harvest Show.
Comment and share your opinions on current events.
Watch the most inspiring guest interviews right here.
Watch my weekly video updates from Israel.
Facebook.com/The Harvest Show. Like us today.
And we'd love for you to go visit The Harvest Facebook page. A lot of good content there. Stuff you're not going to see anywhere else, especially those video logs, the vlogs from Brian Bush. You got to like us, though, to get access to that. And we're pushing to see if we can get 2,000 Facebook likes. I think we're really close. I think we're close to within 100. And so today, just take a moment, get onto your Facebook page, go over to our page, and give us a quick like. You can also connect via Twitter and YouTube. But there you see that little icon up there in the header. Like us, and we want to say thank you for doing that. Also want to say thank you for supporting LeSEA's Prayer Line here, one of the cornerstone ministries that reaches out to, here's from 10 to 12,000 callers and folks writing in each and every month. This month we've been kind of saying we need your help, and some of you have responded. If you've yet to respond, we ask you to do that now as we're coming to the close of the month. It takes about $32,000, as you know, Valerie, to keep Prayer Line operating. And for anyone who sends in a gift this month to help out with LeSEA's Prayer Line initiative, we want to send you this wonderful CD of some of Dr. Sumrall's teachings on the topic of prayer. He is an authority on many things, and prayer was one of them. And his prayer life was something that we can model ours after, but it wasn't a whole lot of fluff. It was pretty much, let's get this done, Jesus. And it was prayer towards God, but it was also that weapon of prayer to use against the enemy. And so rather than, you know, praying for healing or praying for someone to be delivered, it's come out in Jesus' name. That's a powerful prayer right there.
That's right. Yeah. Kind of reminds me of my mother when she would pray for me when I was a little girl, just dealing with the flu or misbehaving in school. She would command it to go in Jesus' name. You know, we've been doing that for more than 40 years here at LeSEA Broadcasting. It was more than 40 years ago that Dr. Sumrall started a prayer line called May I Help You Please? And we've been doing that now for more than 40 years, but we need your help. 10 to 12,000 people call in every month requesting prayer. You know, what we do is there's no, you know, this is not magic. We go to the Lord in prayer. We ask him, we go to him, and we intercede on your behalf. And that's why we need your help, so that we can continue to reach people with prayer and the good news of Jesus Christ. You know, can you imagine 12,000 callers calling in, requesting prayer mm-hmm. from around the world? We need your help. So for a gift of any amount, $5, $10, $500 to keep prayer line going, we would be so appreciative.
And you can call 1-800-365-3732. That is also, as you know, the number for Prayer Line itself. And so if you're going to sow into the ministry of Prayer Line and you've got any specific prayer requests in your life, things that you really would like to see God's answered intervention on, we want to pray with you today. And then don't forget, this month of November, as Pete Summerall, the president and CEO of LeSEA Broadcasting, is in Israel, he's going to be taking your prayer requests to the Western Wall. And so if you'd like him to do that, you can let our phone volunteers know as well. I want to say thank you for joining us here on Harvest Today. We'll see you tomorrow.
You know, there are so few things in this world that you can count on anymore, especially when it comes to our financial future and planning for retirement. We live in a dynamic world defined by change. But when it comes to securing our retirement income, we want stability, not uncertainty. And that's why I consistently talk about charitable gift annuities. A gift annuity provides a safe and steady income stream which is fixed for life. And you are investing into changing lives for Jesus Christ at the same time. If you are over 49 and a half years of age and you have at least $10,000 in a savings account or CD, call us today. Let us show you how you can have at least one form of retirement income that you can count on. When you lay up your treasure in heaven, you can count on it being there, waiting for you. So call us today and let us help you have a secure income for the rest of your life.
Today is your day. This is your moment. Life is calling. It's time to get back that extra spark that you've been missing, and it's simple with Mineral Concentrate, an all-natural trace mineral product designed to promote energy and focus without sugar nor caffeine. Call 1-800-965-2345 or log on to mhclife.com. Today is your day. It's time for life.
The Harvest Show is produced by LeSEA Broadcasting and is viewer supported by people just like you. Thank you for inviting us into your home today.